Hello guys, welcome to my channel Chem Insider. So in today's class we are going to start a new chapter of class 11, that is the second chapter, Structure of an Atom. So for structure of an atom, we have discussed certain laws or principles in the previous chapter. Out of that, the one which is more important was Dalton's atomic theory. Dalton's atomic theory explained us that certain points which he classified or proposed, those were, out of those, one was very important certainly, and that was atoms cannot be further divided. Right? Dalton said atoms cannot be further divided, and then nothing but those are atoms are non-divisible. So this was the statement which was given by Dalton in his Dalton's atomic theory, in his own atomic theory. Later, certain scientists in the late 19th century and earlier 20th century found that atom does contain certain composition which made them different from other elements. Like for example, if you consider an atom of carbon, it has certain different properties when compared to the atom of hydrogen. So we can clearly say that those atoms might be different with one another just because they might have a different composition present in them. So which led to a complete concept where scientists had to explain certain points in order to prove that particular composition of an atom. Those were, if you are saying that the atom is can be divided into further parts, first you need to explain how an element can react with other element if those two are differently composited. And second one is, if you are treating an atom with certain particles present in the, let us say, subatomic particles, so those particles have to explain the stability of a given atom. Let us say, if this is an atom which you are considering, then if you divide this into certain composited particles, then those should explain the stability of this particular atom. So these certain challenges made true that for a particular scientist, in order to propose a composition of different atom, the different composition has to explain those concepts clearly. So in the year 19th century, Michael Faraday came across a theory where he experimented the certain compounds, that he said that electrolytes can conduct electricity. Michael Faraday observed that electrolytes may conduct electricity once they are allowed to pass through certain electrodes. So what he did was, he took some electrodes of metals and dipped them in certain elemental solutions, and he observed that electric current was passing through them. So using that particular theory, he said that we might have a different composition for a given atom. And for that, he constituted an experiment called cathode ray tube experiment. And then we come across a new concept called subatomic particles. Then we come across a new topic called subatomic particles. These subatomic particles was first clearly explained by Michael Faraday in his cathode ray tube experiment. So in this cathode ray tube experiment, what he did was, he took an apparatus which was an elongated cylindrical glass tube such as like this. He took an elongated cylindrical glass tube. At two ends of this glass tube, he took a metal sheet. He took metal sheets. One, he set it as cathode, which holds a negative charge, and the other one he said it is anode. So let us say we are marking our cathode in red. So this is cathode, which has a negative charge, and an anode, which has a positive charge. And the gas present in this was completely known. So he used a completely known gas for complete transaction or of transition of electrons or something like that. So what he said was, once these two electrodes are connected to a high-end battery or a high-voltage source, he observed that there was some movement along the particles from cathode to anode. So that is, he took the cathode ray tube and created a certain vacuum area and observed that on connecting those two anodes to a high-end source of battery and allowing electric current to pass through the cathodes, he observed that certain particles were flowing from cathode to anode. This movement of particles were not exactly to be seen to our naked eyes, So therefore, what he did was, he painted the one end of the tube that is behind the anode with a zinc sulfide. So he painted the surface area behind the zinc anode surface as from zinc sulfide. He used zinc sulfide and painted the crossover behind the anode in order to get a complete reading of the complete particles which are passing. So once they are allowed to pass through from cathode to anode, he observed that this fluorescent zinc sulfide, this phosphorescent zinc sulfide had black dots appeared after the complete transmission from cathode to anode. So those black dots were nothing but the movement of particles which was arise due to movement of particles from cathode to anode. So this is how we explained there are certain particles present in the gas particles if you are considering those high-end electrodes which are connected to a high-end battery. Now he just came a conclusion there might be particles present in the atom and those particles can be said as subatomic particles. But he didn't know what was the exact composition of a particle. So therefore, what he did was he kept a complete electrical charge. He kept a complete electrical charge on one end of the cathode ray tube, such as like this, in this side. So he kept an electrical charge on this side and he observed certain similarities with respect to a negative field of electrons. So negative charge. So he observed certain similarities of these particles with respect to a negative charge species. So therefore, he concluded 5 or 6 points which explained his cathode ray tube experiment for discovery of a certain composited subatomic particle which he called them as electrons. So thus, we came across our first subatomic particles discovery, that is discovery of electron. So electron was first discovered by Michael Faraday using cathode ray tube. So in this experiment what he did was, he took a cathode ray tube which was a glass tube, and on that tube we had two ends held by two metal sheets, one which was cathode and the other one which was anode. And further, those two are connected to a high-end source of a battery. And he also painted zinc sulfide phosphorescent on the anode end of the battery in order to get the complete reading of charged particles moving from one end to the other end. So he gave, as I said, he gave some certain points in order to explain the complete theory. Those points were, first one, he said that we had particles moving from cathode to anode because he found there are certain white dots arise on the phosphorescent sheet. He observed that there were certain white dots present on the phosphorescent sheet, white dots present on the phosphorescent sheet side of the zinc sulfide, which led to a conclusion that there might be particles present. So that particles confirmation was done by painting the one end of the electrode with zinc sulfide phosphorescent. So next, the second point, he said that the cathode rays, the particles were moved in a single direction, that is from cathode to anode. He observed that particles were always moving present in the atom. Particles present in the atom were always moving from cathode to anode. He observed that particles were moving from cathode to anode. As there were no change in the direction, it was only unidirectional. Next, in the absence of electrical or magnetic field, before adding this electrical magnetic field, what he observed, in the absence of an electrical or magnetic field, in absence of electric or magnetic field, the cathode ray which was passed from the cathode was unidirectional, which was moving unaltered or undisturbed. In the absence of electric or magnetic field, the cathode rays which were passing from cathode to anode was unidirectional. It did not change its movement of direction. Next, in the presence of electrical or magnetic field, then he applied an electric or magnetic field and he observed that, that is in presence of electrical or magnetic field, those particles present in that atom was acting similar to a negative charged species, therefore he called those particles or subatomic particles as electrons. So he called them as electrons, denoted by the symbol e to the power minus. So he called them as electrons with a negative charge similar to a negative charge species when applied a electrical or magnetic field on the cathode ray tube. And the last point he explained was the cathode gas, which was the gas present inside the cathode ray tube, had nothing to do with the movement of cathode rays from cathode to anode or the charge of the electron. That is, the gas which was taken inside the cathode tube did not alter any of the process which was carried out by the cathode, movement of particles from cathode to anode. Okay, so therefore the charge present on an electron was independent of the metal which was used as electrode and the gas which was taken inside the cathode tube. So that is the last point, that is, the charge on the electron or the movement of electron was nothing to do or did not depend upon the metal used as electrode, or on gas taken in the cathode tube, This was about the five properties which Faraday explained for discovery of electron using a cathode ray tube experiment. So in this experiment, what he said was, we'll start once again. So that is, when Michael Faraday took an example of electrolyte conducting electric current, he constituted an experimental setup in which he took a glass tube with two ends sealed by two metal sheets considered as electrodes, and those which connected to a high-end battery source was observed to allow movement of particles from cathode to anode in the form of rays, which we call them as cathode rays. So these rays are called cathode rays. So since this cathode rays was not visible for naked eye, what he did was, he just slightly altered the apparatus and he painted zinc sulfide phosphorescent on the side behind the anode electrode. So once that was done, the movement of particles was confirmed by the white dots appeared because of the heating created by particles passed through the anode and on them colliding on the sides of the zinc sulfide phosphorescent. So that confirmed that there might be a particle present inside the atom. So which was later confirmed by providing an electric and magnetic field to respect to the cathode tube, which explained that those particles had some change in their reaction or change in their expressions with respect to its movement from cathode to anode. That was confirmed as similar to a negative charge species, which he said them as, therefore he called them as electrons with a negative charge. And then he further said that the charge present on the particles which was moving from left to right, that is from cathode to anode, was independent of the metal which we have used as electrode and not independent of the gas which was taken inside the cathode ray tube. So this was about the discovery of electrons from Michael Faraday. So later we came across a theory from J.J. Thomson, in which he said that these electrons might be having some charge which can be defined with respect to their mass values. So therefore, he gave away an expression called charge to mass ratio. He gave an expression for charge to mass ratio and determined its value with controlling electrical and magnetic field whence they are applied on the cathode ray tube which was passed to a cathode rays. So we'll discuss that now. So this is what the experimental set up for J.J. Thomson's charts to mass ratio determination. So, if you observe over here, we have two additional components with respect to the cathode ray tube. So, those are an electrical field applied because of the electrodes taken and a magnetic field taken because of the magnet. Okay. So, if you ignore these two, this is nothing but a simple cathode ray tube. We have slightly altered the structure, that is J.J. Thomson has slightly altered the structure. So, J.J. Thomson in the year 1898, said that a molecule, an atom has certain amount of composition present in it, and he supported the Dalton's theory. But what he further did was, he determined the charge to mass ratio present in a given atom, or that is, it is a subatomic particle present in the given atom. So, he determined the charge to mass ratio of that particular subatomic particle, which was explained by John Dalton. So, what he did was, he took a cathode and anode in a sealed tube, along with an electrical field and magnetic field which are perpendicular to each other. An electrical field and a magnetic field which are perpendicular to each other, and further, those two, both electrical field and magnetic field, are again perpendicular to the incoming cathode rays. So, he connected the cathode and the anode to a high-end battery source. Once they are allowed to pass the high-end current, the cathode was subjected to, was expected to release a cathode ray, which was passed through the anode. And further, we observed that passed cathode ray was expected on the fluorescent zinc sulfide. So now, instead of taking a zinc sulfide fluorescent next to an anode, we used a certain arrangement of electrical field and magnetic field between the anode and the zinc sulfide phosphorescent. So what he did was, he took three cases of observation. In the first case, he observed that on the absence of electrical field, he took out the complete electric field present and just installed the magnetic field. So in the presence of magnetic field or in the absence of electrical field, he observed that the anode rays, which cathode rays which are passed through the anode, was slightly deflected in a different direction than its actual direction in the absence of electric field and in the presence of magnetic field. He observed the incoming cathode ray deflected to a certain range. Let us say it is collected at the point A. So in this point, we have magnetic field, but no electrical field. Okay. And then in the second case, he nullified the complete magnetic field in the experiment and just added the electrical field. And he observed that there was a certain deflection, but in the opposite direction, let us say at C. So here we have just electrical field. Okay. So now he came across the two conclusions. One, in the presence of magnetic field, the electron or the cathode ray deflects in a different direction with respect to a presence of just an electrical field. Later, what he did was, for the third condition, he controlled both magnetic field and electric field. That is, he either increased the magnetic field and decreased the electric field in such a way that it starts to combine one another, that is, the point A and B are, A and C are coming close to one another and started to meet at point P, which is nothing but the expected straight line of cathode ray, which is passed through anode and colliding at the zinc sulfide phase. So, on controlling the magnetic field and the electrical field, he observed that we come to a point at B where both get combined with one another and increases the intensity of the cathode ray coming. So using that controlled magnitudes of magnetic field and electric field, he came across a relation of charge to mass ratio of the electron, which was determined by Dalton, that is E by ME is equal to 1.758 into 10 power 11 coulombs per kg. He came across the value that charge by mass of an electron is equal to 1.758 into 10 to the power 11 coulomb per kg. So here E is the charge on electron, ME is mass of electron. Charge of electron is given in coulombs, whereas mass of electrons is given in kg. So 1.758 into 10 to the power 11 coulombs per kg. This is what about the charge to mass ratio, which was determined by J.J. Thomson. So what he did actually was hit a cathode and anode in a huge tank of cathode tube, and in which he separated zinc and zinc sulfide and anode tube by keeping a magnetic field and electric field perpendicular to one another, which are further perpendicular to the incoming cathode ray. So he observed three conditions of deflections, one in which he completely nullified the electric field and applied just the magnetic field. So due to the presence of magnetic field, he observed the deflection and observed the point of collision at A. And in the second case of complete zero magnetic field and just electrical field, he observed the deflection at C. And in the third case, he controlled both magnetic field and electric field in such a way that this cathode ray is to collide with zinc sulfide with its expected value of zero field of electrical or magnetic field. So using that controlled magnitude values, he determined that charge to mass ratio of electron is equal to 1.758 into 10 to the power 11 coulomb per kg. So this is how we come across charge to mass ratio of electron. So this is about for today. In the next class, we are going to discuss about discovery of protons and neutrons and further about different atomic theory proposed by different scientists. So if you have understood the discovery of electron and the J.J. Thomson's model in order to explain the charge to mass ratio, please do subscribe to my channel and like the video, and please do share this among your friends. If there are need of certain videos, there will be get use of this. And if you have any doubts, please do comment down below. And you can also mail me those doubts if you have any doubt regarding the stock test which I explained. I have given the mail address in the description box. Thank you for watching.